Hey, you lot, how's it going? I'm squirt of negative one, but if you really insist, you can call me squirt. Speaking of squirting, today we're going to be talking about bodily fluids, although probably just like blood and stuff. Okay, so if you're new, this is my third episode in my series on the physics of the human body. So do go back and learn about forces in motion and work and energy and all that. Okay, first pretest. What fluid or homogeneous mixture of fluids is most abundant on the surface of the Earth by volume? Time's up. Did you guess water? Well, you're wrong. There are about 1,400 million cubic kilometers of water on Earth, but there's about twice as much as another mixture of fluids, which we collectively call air. Point being, fluids are not just liquids. They're any substance that can flow and conform to the bounds of its container. So liquids, gases, and also the high temperature charge separated phase that is known as plasma. Though hopefully the only plasma your body is interacting with is blood plasma, which is a lot colder. To understand the behaviors of fluids, we first need to know what pressure is. When we were talking about solids, all you needed was a force. I can poke my calculator and it moves. But if I poke a puddle of water, it most likely just deforms around my finger without any net motion in that direction. To move the whole puddle, I need to exert a force over a larger area. So how do we measure this? That's pressure. Pressure is force over area. There are three different sources of pressure in fluid. First is the pressure from external forces, such as my fingers on the puddle or your lungs compressing as you exhale. This pressure is just force over area. Second is the pressure due to the weight of the fluid. So as you go deeper in, you have more and more weight from the upper parts of the fluid pushing down on you. That's why the pressure's higher when you go deeper underwater and you might start to feel your ears hurt or something. This pressure is equal to the pressure at the surface plus another term that represents how much weight you have pushing on top of you, which is the density times acceleration due to gravity times your relative height compared to the surface. Both of these two can also apply to solids, though in that case they're usually referred to as stress. And then last, there's pressure due to the interaction between the molecules. Each molecule is bumping up against each other one, exerting little mini forces on each collision. Changes in this pressure are especially relevant in a gas where volume can be easily changed. What you're seeing here is the ideal gas law. N is the number of molecules, usually in moles, in your substance. If you have more molecules in the same space, they're going to jostle each other more. R is just the universal gas constant. T is temperature. At higher temperatures, molecules are moving around more, increasing collisions and thereby pressure. V is volume, so as volume increases, pressure goes down and vice versa. Let's use this ideal gas law for a moment to model how we breathe. Fluids move when there's a net pressure, or in other words, a pressure difference between regions on either side of the fluid, i.e. a pressure gradient. So in order to breathe, we must create a pressure gradient. We do this by increasing volume, expanding the rib cage, dropping the diaphragm. Now air rushes into our lungs following the pressure gradient. As molecules enter, pressure again rises until it's again equal with the atmospheric pressure. We then decrease the volume, increasing the pressure, and air flows back out, and you do it all again. What about fluids that don't pool up but just keep flowing? Specifically, let's talk about blood. Blood is kept flowing by a pressure gradient high at the aorta, then decreasing over the arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, veins, and finally lowest at the vena cava. For simplicity, let's assume blood flow is steady, meaning that the blood at a designated spot will always be moving at the same velocity, even as different blood comes through and fills in that role. In reality, it fluctuates with your heartbeat, as does pressure, which is why you can feel a heartbeat somewhere other than your actual heart. But it's still oscillating periodically and coming back to the same value each time, unless you go exercise or drink a lot of sugary stuff or your crush walks into the room. Oh wait, let's fix that. There we go. Blood flow is also generally laminar, which means that it's not turbulent and that it flows in a pattern where the fluid next to the walls flows more slowly due to friction than the fluid at the center of the passage. Blood is only turbulent when moved at higher speeds, such as in the aorta directly after a heartbeat, creating the sound that you hear with a stethoscope. Flow rate is defined as the volume passing through a cross-sectional plane over a given amount of time. It can also be defined as the cross-sectional area of that plane times the velocity of the fluid. Flow rate in must equal flow rate out unless you're pooling up or somehow adding fluid into the system. So then let's say that overall blood doesn't change flow rate and A and V therefore are inversely proportional. So now as we go from the aorta to a tiny capillary, speed increases, right? Wrong. Flow rate doesn't change, but only over all paths summed. The flow rate over all of the capillaries in your body is equal to the flow rate in the aorta. But there are about 10 billion capillaries in one aorta. So blood actually moves slower through the capillaries, which is useful because we need it to slow down so that you can have diffusion across the walls of the capillaries so that the blood does its purpose of transporting oxygen, nutrients, and waste products in and out of the cells of your body. Speed also depends on height due to the pressure of the fluid's weight. So lower equivalent blood vessels have higher pressure and higher speed. Your body is used to accommodating. One thing you can do is dilate each of the blood vessels so that you have a larger cross-sectional area, and then the blood moves both slower and has a lower pressure on it. This is why when you've been standing up for a long time, your feet maybe start to get swollen. But sometimes your body can't adapt quickly enough. So if you stand up way too quickly, blood will rush away from your head and you might feel lightheaded. Big word for the day, sphygmomanometer. That's the cuff they put on your upper arm when they want to measure your blood pressure. They specifically put it at the height of your heart to avoid the effects of vertical distance. How it works is they first inflate it enough to cut off blood flow. They then release pressure until blood flows turbulently just at the top of the pressure wave, producing a sound. This gives the systolic blood pressure. Once the pressure gets even further down, your blood is flowing continuously, and the sound from the turbulent flow goes away. Your body monitors the pressures of all its fluids, often without you realizing, keeping it all in homeostasis. Pressure in the eye has to be just high enough that the eye won't collapse, but also low enough that it won't damage the optic nerve, causing glaucoma. The brain is also very sensitive when it comes to pressure in the cerebrospinal fluid. During a cerebral hemorrhage, blood is released, increasing pressure in the brain. This is treated with surgery by removing the excess blood and sewing up those blood vessels. Most of the fluid interactions in your body happen without your conscious awareness. But let's take an instance that pops on your radar regularly. But first I need a bathroom break. Okay, I'm back. What made me get up was a notification from my bladder telling me that it had maybe about 200 milliliters in it, and it was probably a good idea to go empty it out. Liquid cannot compress a lot, so the bladder has to expand to take on its cargo. The walls of your bladder are solid, so they experience stress. Stress responds with strain, which is deformation. Your bladder can take a lot of strain, filling up to about 500 milliliters. After that, you eventually pass the elastic region of a solid, but our bodies are wired not to let us do that. If I'd not responded to my bladder just now, it would have shut up and then waited until maybe 400 milliliters when it would have started screaming at me again. Be careful about straining your bladder too much, though. Ever heard of Tycho Brahe? He was a Danish astronomer, and the cause of his death is kind of debatable. It might have been mercury poisoning, but it might have also been holding his pee too long. Tycho would attend dinners with colleagues, drink a lot, and then refuse to relieve himself, out of etiquette. He supposedly injured his bladder from this repeated punishment and died from the resulting infection. Just one story, but perhaps worthy of a little departure from etiquette? So there you go, fluids of the body. Like this video if you learned something new, and subscribe if you want to keep learning. Join me next week for the electricity behind how we think, and in the meantime, don't be like Tycho Brahe. Oh, and if you feel the pressure of life getting to you, just take a few deep breaths. Under pressure.
The guitarist looks so bored.